and you're coming out today, because this is truly an American thing you're doing. You're standing up, you're addressing...
Don't patronize!
What are you going to do?
Here's my point of view on the ACA. And I've said this in hearings this week in Congress, and I've also said it to my colleagues, that we need to repair and fix what is not working and keep it.
Let's get the statement so we can argue it later.
It is one of the problems in our country today, and I've said this about some of my conservative friends, but I've also said it about some of my progressive friends. We talk past each other, we don't listen to each other. Right. So hopefully you will listen to what I have to say here, because I'm hearing from many people, and I've talked to many people who share your point of view on this particular topic. So my point of view is that we need to fix and repair what's not working, keep what is working. There are a couple of things that
there are some
principles that are contained within the ACA that I support. Namely, for instance, the pre-existing conditions.
After 18 months, we
already had a law in New York, for instance, when I was in the legislature years ago. I voted for that. The ACA nationalized that law. There are other provisions about kids on their parents' health plans up until they're 26. I think there's strong support for that.
What about free contraceptives?
There is also a consensus, and I just had a hearing this week in the Budget Committee, which I'm privileged now to serve on. My very first hearing, I sat there for 3 hours.
Let him finish. Until I got my chance to ask the question.
And we had conservative and liberal experts sitting before us. And what was remarkable, if you sat there for 3 hours and listened to them, the remarkable degree of consensus as to some of the regulatory and statutory fixes that have to take place. And I think if we can work together across the aisle, we can come up with things that will fix what is the problem. Now,
the problem is you're voting with the Trump agenda. And you will find
small business people and people that are, especially who are running employer-based health plans, who will tell you that their premiums have skyrocketed.
That's a lie.
No, not true.
One of the fundamental things in our health system today is that if you have employer-provided health care, it is not taxable to the individual. However, if you are someone who doesn't receive employer-provided health care, or if you're a sole proprietor, or someone who's in the individual market, you have to pay for health care with after-tax dollars. That is an inequity that I would like to fix.
We want your health care.
We want your health care.
That is an inequity.
Let him finish.
Why don't you just start answering some of the questions? Because we don't trust you. Every Democrat country has
universal single-payer health care. What? Maybe it's because you're so goddamn crazy.
Congress has it too.
How do you feel about the Muslim ban?
Someone asked me a question. How do I feel about a Muslim ban? And I said, back in the campaign, I don't support that.
Where's your voice?
Stand up and speak out and prevent.
On the issue, we want you to be loud and clear, not just here.
We're here on all issues. We're here because we want you to represent us, also here, because we united in solidarity.
So, for instance, I have taken a public position. I actually did during the campaign. It actually didn't get covered very much. But I did not support, I do not support, and I won't vote for a defunding of Planned Parenthood.
Whoa! All right! Yeah. Good.
That's not what you said! That's not what you said!
Well,
that's
got
not
us.
What you said yesterday! So what about the local man?
What I said in Philadelphia was basically this is not the vehicle where you should not put the Planned Parenthood piece in this bill.
Because we're the enemy, right? Come on, let's finish.
If you want to put it in another bill, I'm happy to vote against what you put in a different bill.
You said I have no problem. You said I have no problem. They didn't finish the call. I did not read the recording.
What I'm trying to say to you, and I clarified this with WAMC, you can see it on their website. I clarified it that this is simply not the vehicle that you should be dealing with this. If you want to deal with it somewhere else, I'll be voting against that. But I said I don't have a problem if you want to bring it up somewhere else. I'll vote against that. Let me just tell you that just like it was when I ran and I was asked the question about the two presidential candidates, I said regardless of who gets elected, I'll support them if I agree with them, and if I don't, I won't. Good. And so that's where my position is. I don't agree with a Muslim ban.
Why didn't you vote yes? This gentleman wants to ask me a question.
So, Representative Faso, you said that you were concerned that the rates have gone up on Obamacare. You were in the state legislature in 2010. From the state, let me finish my question.
I left in 2002.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I tried to run for governor and I lost that election. In
2010, the New York State Legislature established rate regulation of health insurance rates, as I'm sure you know.
Yes.
They were deregulated under Pataki. Did you support, and will you, and in addition to that, the Republican conference, your party, the Republicans, every year, and they proposed in their budget program to deregulate, to remove the 2010 reinstitution of rate regulation in New York State. They propose it every year in their budget. So will you urge your Republican colleagues and Mr. Flanagan to stop proposing deregulation of health insurance rates if you're concerned about high rates under Obamacare? Yeah. Yes or no? Have you looked at that law?
I have looked at that, and no, I don't agree with your position. Because it sounds like you're being inconsistent a little bit. No, it's more complicated than what your question represents. And it has to do with a question of whether or not insurers are able to recoup enough to pay for claims and benefits, etc. There's such a thing called medical loss ratio.
Medical loss ratio is 85%.
And the medical loss ratio means that 85% of all the premium dollar has to be paid in benefits.
I'm completely familiar with it.
And we're getting a little in the weeds here.
We need some money for the wall, right?
But the fact is that the premiums that an insurer will charge are regulated. The question is whether or not they should have been subject to further regulation from the Department of Financial Services. And I think history has shown based upon some of the rates that DFS approved. And mind you, this is a state level issue we're talking about. Well, but history has shown that approach hasn't worked. It hasn't
I have a question real quickly.
If you're concerned about high health insurance,
there are some other reasons.
I have a question up here.
The people that are detained right now at the airport, the Iraqi family, the translator, the people that are...
Yeah, how come you're
supporting
right now? They're
fighting for those people. They're separated from their wives and their children. What are we going to do about this? Inhuman.
The lady has asked me this question about the certain Iraqis who previously had visas who were separated or stopped at the airport.
Yes. 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 So, they have
and I don't
or
agree.
Maybe he's saying they previously had visas for a reason.
No, I don't agree with the policy.
Question over here.
I have to assess it. I don't know what I will do, but I have to look at, understand the totality of what the proposal is and what the order was.
Is there a proposal?
You are in desperate times.
Well, I'm not going to characterize it that way, but I will say that when I go back to Washington on Monday, this is something that I'm going to look into because I want to get more facts before I speak.
Wrong
and,
is wrong.
Give you an opinion on it. I can tell you this. I don't agree with the policy as I've read about it.
Okay, I have a question for you. How about, I have a question right here.
Horn, please.
Very simple. Does it make sense to repeal ACA before you have another plan? Why throw out the whole, I mean, we worked for decades to get this close to having health insurance. Okay, just reasonably speaking, there are some problems with it. Why not keep it and work on those individual problems?
And take the credit for it.
And why not start by saying you want to keep it?
We don't care.
That's called leadership.
It's been a lot of politics. We fought a lot of politics. We fought a lot of wheeling and dealing for the insurance companies. We fought them really hard, and we got to this place
They were in bed on the passage of the ACA.
I have a quick question.
The lady is asking me a question about why don't you have the full replacement before there's a repeal, and actually my view is that what we should do is that we should fix what doesn't work and keep what does before we do anything else.
That was not the question. That was not the question.
And you guys fix it. Call it what you like. But you work on fixing it.
Not repeal.
There's no reason to repeal it.
There are more people that want out with the things.
Wait a second. The saxophone guy has two questions.
Okay. Two quick things. One, on Vox Pop the other day, someone mentioned to you that there's 600 million.
We're watching you.
We're taking notes.
Okay, here we go. Hang on.
Two-way street.
The ACA provides us with $600 million.
To the state of New York.
And our district is supposed to get about $6 million of that. And we were asking what you are planning to do when you repeal the ACA to come up with that $6 million. You said that the taxpayers are going to have to absorb that cost. What do you mean by that? Is that like a tax and spend Republican kind of thing?
So I detect a little cynicism in that question. But I think I'm better without this. What I was alluding to was New York has a special problem with the ACA because we have such a large Medicaid expansion. So we are meeting already with my colleagues on how we deal with this. We're talking to the state and there are various proposals on Medicaid. The question is,
There are about 20 states that expanded, or about 25 states that expanded, and about the rest of them didn't. So the states that expanded, we need to try to hold harmless those states in terms of their Medicaid allocation, while figuring out what do we do about the states that didn't expand, because they will rightly say, oh, wait a second, we didn't expand, now the states that expanded, they're going to get a benefit, and we don't.
The reason why this is getting in place is because you don't want an African American president to have a legacy.
I don't agree with that.
Okay, but now here's the other question. One of the questions. And you look good. You look real good. Here's an easy one. Softball. Could you please post your schedule, because numerous people have...
Yes!
I will certainly take that under consideration. Basically,
I work as a public servant. You're supposed to help us out and listen to the people. We shouldn't have to come to your house to get your ear.
Here's my answer to that. We are so intensely in Washington.
I will look at coming up with
a system whereby I can reasonably post public meetings where I'm going to be at. I've been there 3 weeks, and I haven't really dealt with this question yet. But I'm going to deal with it.
Okay.
Health care really needs to be handled. You have no idea.
I'm
getting every bit of
it. HR 7. Okay. Access to abortion under Obamacare. Why did you vote yes on HR 7?
What HR 7 made under statutory law, the existing Hyde Amendment, which is an appropriation, but it also said, and it's been law for 40 years. I said in the campaign that I supported the Hyde Amendment, and that's been consistently my position. What the legislation also did, it said if you get a subsidy, a taxpayer-paid subsidy, that portion of the subsidy can't be used to pay for abortion, but you could always add to that if you wanted in your own plan. So it's consistent with my position. I said this in the campaign, I've said it the entire time I ran. It is very consistent with my position. But so that's why I voted for it.
Insurance companies that do ACA, they cannot offer a plan that covers abortion, which means people covered under ACA cannot get a plan that's under ACA. And it's a disincentive for insurance companies to participate in the ACA, weakening support for access to abortion and women's right to choose.
They can offer a rider to provide that.
But will they?
Well,
it's a disincentive.
Yes, I can't tell you whether they will or not.
And you voted yes.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's my position.
You're hurting women by doing that. Our bodies, women have a right to choose.
Ma'am, I said when I ran that I supported the Hyde Amendment, and that's why I voted for that.
But you're strengthening the Hyde Amendment. You're not just supporting it, you're strengthening it.
It's consistent with what I said during the election. And
we
oppose
it.
I understand that. I understand your point of view, and I respect it.
I have a question. First of all, I would like to say I respect the fact that you're standing there talking to us.
To protest, to your right to redress your grievances.
We need more than just the right to protest. Come on, man.
I totally believe in it.
You can't ignore it.
Second part. Okay, here comes the kicker.
No, it's not bad.
All right.
I'm frightened.
Yes.
I've lived in New York, first New York City for 34 years, and now I've lived up here in Columbia County for 2 years. Mm-hmm. I've never seen anything in Washington like what I'm seeing now, and he scares the crap out of me.
Yeah, a lot of gag orders have been paid off.
And the enablers around him, the Steve Bannon.
He scares you too, you know.
Are you scared, John?
They
Donald Trump has been with 14 and 13 years.
We're frightened about what's going to happen to the country. And we depend on the legislative branch to be the check and balance on that.
Be a leader! Be a leader!
That's a very good question. I hear it from people all over, and all I can tell you is that I'm going to fight very hard to uphold our Constitution, to uphold our Bill of Rights, to uphold the rights of people who might be here legally and they're stopped at an airport. I'm going to uphold the rights of people to protest and uphold the rights of people to say their piece. And I'm going to vote in the Congress to make sure that any president, whether it was Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, is kept within the confines of what the law and the Constitution say. Thanks for coming.
What's the question?
Are you going to vote for HR 669?
You're going to pay for the law. If you're on the budget committee, would you be willing to pay?
You know, the barrier between the U.S. and Mexico was authorized in 2006, and it's a matter of appropriation. And I want to look at whether there are some areas where the topography doesn't lend itself to a physical barrier. So we have to be smart about using technology, whether it's advanced surveillance, etc., to make sure the border is secure.
Waste of money.
Waste of money.
You let planes go to walls.
It depends on what I find when I investigate this, because I don't know exactly where we should have a physical barrier, where we don't.
Do you think
and
that
what
that
it costs?
We shouldn't have one.
Economically incompetent, that is.
Some of it can be covered with remote surveillance and drones. We have different technology that we didn't have 10 years ago. So I think we have to be careful about how we spend our money.
Right.
Do you trust Donald? I don't want to waste money building a barrier that's unnecessary.
Do you trust Donald and the rest of you? Do you trust him?
Can you expand your website? There's a picture. Can you get back a picture of somebody? A picture of somebody, it says national security, and we have Ayatollah, whoever that is. Yeah.
That's Khomeini.
Okay, but you have this under national security.
That's on this my campaign website.
I know, exactly.
Yeah. You need to clean it up.
You don't think that is? It is. I, as a Jew, am offended by this.
Well, let me tell you.
I, as a Jew, am offended by this.
I'm not offended by that.
I am.
People are dying there. I am from Afghanistan.
This is offensive to Muslims.
One of the things that dishonored the United States was when we abandoned the people that fought with us in Laos and in Vietnam, and it was a disgrace that we abandoned many of those people. And there are many people, and I've talked to many. In fact, I have colleagues who fought in Afghanistan and fought in Iraq. One colleague who lost both his legs, a new freshman congressman from Florida in Afghanistan. And we rely upon many people in both Iraq and Afghanistan who supported and helped the United States cause and helped to defend against the Taliban and against ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Chris Gibson will tell you that ISIS is really Al-Qaeda in Anbar province. So
George Bush created it.
We should not abandon people that supported us.
But that's not what Trump is saying. Trump is saying, I will ban Muslims, not the people who didn't support us.
That is not what I'm saying.
Can you change your website?
I will look at that again. I haven't looked at that in many months.
I know, but this is
today. I will take a look. You have my assurance.
How are you prepared for this government?
Mayor.
You said you're supporting.
How will you keep? I'm sorry.
What about the laws and pumps and pumps that are being the president? No one's calling him to Matt for that at all. They're letting it go right over. And another thing is his son-in-law in the White House. That's also against the law.
No, well, I think on the question of the son-in-law, I think the law is very clear on that, that that is not against the law.
Why not?
Come on.
Very clear that it is.
Hang on, I want the other part.
Yeah.
The emoluments clause is something that's never been litigated, but the...
You think it's a joke? You're laughing.
Why do you laugh? Why do you even? How can you protect him in any way?
No, yeah. Sir.
No, but really, don't you? Give us a
come on, hang on. Let Mr. Faso.
His answer was.
Let him spin it. Hang on.
Okay.
So give us all a shine.
So the question on the emoluments clause. Frankly, I have never researched it as a lawyer and looked at it. Here's the question. If someone has a even Steven transaction, they purchase a good or service, say a hotel room, and they pay the fair market value, I would say that that is not a violation of the emoluments.
Laundering.
And what he has actually said and stated, and he's going to be held to account on this, that if he makes any profit, he will donate to the government. But it's
that's great. You're not that stupid.
He's made a profit.
Yeah.
So every person that joins that, he's got to give their membership fee then to the government.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of issues around that, but I don't have an answer for you today.
On that Muslim ban, back on the Muslim ban, with the Muslims, why is Saudi Arabia and Jordan, why aren't they on that ban?
Healthcare question.
Yeah, but that was a part of hers. Saudi Arabia and Jordan on the Muslim ban when they bombed us at 9/11.
How do you keep the pre-existing?
HR 669,
hang on, hang on.
Just, you know, about the nuclear, you know, it's a little frightening to have Donald
what
Trump.
What is HR 669?
So explain. It would bring more of you involved in, so he wouldn't be the single...
I'm sorry, your
it's
question
called is... HR 669.
I haven't seen it, but...
You haven't seen it. I already called your office about it yesterday.
I have a healthcare question.
Please take a look at it, because you need to understand we're terrified.
We're terrified.
Healthcare question, Congressman. Congressman, healthcare question.
I grew up right down the road.
What's your name?
Andrea Ennis.
Oh, you're Jerry Ennis's
I'm Jerry
kid?
Ennis's daughter.
Oh.
I'm a school kid. Wife was our school nurse.
Yeah, she still is.
Awesome. I'm not no longer my school nurse, though.
You're more than 18.
I am. Yeah. I have a brain tumor and a spinal condition. And when I was first diagnosed, I was kicked off my insurance because pre-existing conditions were out. And... saying I support this is not good enough. I need you as a human being to say, I promise that we will not take this away from you until I need you to take care of this. We elect you to take care of us.
Yes.
Not all politics are pre-existing condition clause without the amendment.
All right, who's Bullhorn?
Right here, saxophone guy.
Saxophone guy.
Saxophone guy.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's get that schedule.
Thank you, John.
Yeah, I can imagine mobilizing more people than that either. It was hard. Like, logistically, at the end, like, getting anybody in. Anyway, like, you were even your march. There were, like, way more people. They turned you away because they thought it would be dangerous at some point. They couldn't have any more people there. You know, just got so big. Like, the only way it could be bigger is just, like, if everybody just went outside. Or marching, like, wherever they are. Because just logistically, we couldn't get any more people moved or out, or it was just like, even in my own town of Woodstock, which is small, like they didn't have a permit to march down the street, so they were going to just put out the sidewalks. But that couldn't happen because 12 times as many people as they thought were going to come would come, so they just closed the town. And that only decided to do that 3 days before Women's March. Like they weren't going to have a march until then, because I didn't say anything up because it was my town. I was too busy. I was like, they can go someplace else, like right in my town, and then someone else decided to do it. So, like, in my own town.
Thank you for coming right now.
Oh, no, thanks for coming. Like, it wouldn't have been anything if you guys didn't come. You know what I mean? It wouldn't have been anything. And then everybody came and we have some hope. But we have some hope. There's other people. Like today.
You got the best kind of all, I must say.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I appreciate it.
I don't know where I am this time this week.
We'll be here.
And this is what the expert.
Right, that's why I'm like, enjoy. about this yet.
Yeah, absolutely. and I can skip the last name. No, I would just say, I wouldn't get it.
We showed up at the end of the moment.
We've communicated a few times. I recognize you.
All right, Steve, we'll get her in there.
I was scratching.